Good morning. My name is Anita Lee. I'm the Chief Programming Officer here at TIFF. I am so excited to be here this morning to present a very special film with some very special guests after the film. Before I begin the program, I would like to first thank our lead and major sponsors, Bell, RBC, Bulgari, and Visa, for their continued support. Thank you to our major supporters, the Government of Canada, the Government of Ontario, Telefilm Canada, and the City of Toronto for their continued support. This film is eligible for the People's Choice Award, the People's Choice Documentary Award. Vote for your favorite films at tiff.net. We would also like to say a big thank you to Apple TV for providing us with this film. Sidney Poitier was one of the most gifted and charismatic actors the cinema has known. This sweeping documentary crafts a richly detailed portrait, surveying Poitier's films, life story, and litany of accomplishments as an artist and activist who forever changed what it means to be Black in America. Poitier's own words provide the narration, telling the story of a boy born to tomato farmers in the Bahamas. Moving to the U.S. at age 15, he quickly learned the brutal realities of the Jim Crow era, but also found his passion for acting. We'll begin the film right away, but I will share the news that immediately following the screening, we will have a very special extended Q&A. Moderated by Gail King with Oprah Winfrey and the Poitier family. Enjoy your screening. So that was the world premiere of Sidney by Reginald Hudlin, everybody. And as promised, we have very, very special guests joining us now. I'd like to first welcome Gail King to moderate a conversation.
Beings, chess. Are you as excited as I am about what you just saw? Are you still tingling? Yeah, me too. You're in for a real treat because we have the Poitier family here today. We have the producer here today, Derek. We have Oprah here today, so let's go. Starting with Poitier's daughter, Beverly Poitier Henderson, please come on out. Pamela Poitier, please come out. Sherry Poitier, please come out. Anika Poitier, where are you? And Sidney Poitier in the movie. Remember when Sidney said, hello, Sidney P? There she is. Derek Murray is a producer. Thank you, Derek. Is there no chair for Oprah? Oh, okay. Oh, you were supposed to be here. That's okay. We won't move everybody. And Oprah Winfrey, the producer and executive producer. Yes. Yeah. Can everybody just move? Yes. Yes. We're going to play a game of musical chairs before we get started. Okay. I don't know how you feel about this film. I am still so moved by it. I hope that when you tell people about it, and you will, that you will encourage them to see it on the big screen. I've been seeing it on my iPad, so imagine what it's like when you see it on the big screen. So please, when you spread the word, and I know you're gonna do that, because you're all probably on a high the way we all are after watching it. But I want to start with the Poitier girls, because from the moment the movie opens and you see your dad's face on the screen, I wonder what that felt like, because for me, as a little girl, I lived in Turkey, guys, from first grade to sixth grade. And, you know, people just assume all black people know each other. So they would say, does your family know Sidney Poitier? And I would go home and say to my mom and dad, who is Sidney Porter? No. So they would say, yes, we do. We don't know him, but he's a very famous American actor. And there was a magazine called Ebony Magazine, and he was on the cover. So when I saw his face on the screen, when you all saw the movie for the first time, I'm wondering what you thought and how you felt. You go first, Beverly.
For me, it was just good to see his face.
Yes.
It was just good to see his face and good to see him healthy and strong.
Mm-hmm. Did anything surprise you, Anika? We passed the mic? Okay.
No, nothing really surprised me. It was just nice to see his life in his words.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Pamela, you said something about that. I don't know, if you all know about movie and TV production, I said to Oprah, who wrote the track? And she said, there is no track. It is extremely difficult, guys, to tell a story where you hear no narration track, that it just goes from one clip to the next to the next, but the story flows so easily. And you realize the narrator is actually your father, Pamela.
His words, it was really brilliant to have him tell his own story, because no one could tell his story but him.
Yeah.
He will tell you who he is. You ain't gonna tell him who he is.
Yes, yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So that's my dad, and I'm really proud of that. That makes me feel like now the world can know who we knew and who we grew up with.
Who you knew and who you grew up with, yes. Sydney? Was there anything that surprised you or that you learned about your dad and how you felt watching him on the big screen? I'm not kidding. When I saw his face, I had a visceral reaction when I first saw it.
Yeah, well, when I first saw it, I first saw it on a smaller screen, an earlier version, and I just burst into tears initially, just to hear his voice and to see him and to feel him in a way I hadn't felt him in a while because he had been sick for so long. So there was that. There was this like combination of like deep grief, but also like real genuine relief to sort of like have him all around me in my senses. So there was that. There were things in the film that surprised me, such as when he talked about how lonely it was being the only one. That's not something that he let us in on as his children. He was always such a pillar of strength for us and for the world. So to know what that journey actually was for him.
Yes.
And of course it was lonely. And of course now, you know, as an adult, being able to look back and see the weight that he really truly carried for so many people.
And when he said the pressure that he felt, Sidney.
The pressure,
We just look at him, he's so calm and he's so debonair. Even his name sounds like class, Sidney Poitier.
Yeah.
You know, it would not have the same ring, guys, if it was Tom Poitier or Jerry Poitier. The fact that it was Sidney Poitier, there's even something like that made such a difference, I thought.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Sherry, you struck me in the film, you were talking about To Sir With Love, and you said, many people saw him as the actor, but I saw him as a father teaching us all. What did you mean?
My father was the type of man that after he would finish working, he would come home and he would talk about all kinds of information about the world, about life. And we all would sit around the dinner table and I would just be in awe.
Yes.
You know? Anything he said, it was like, oh my goodness.
And Sherry, did he speak in that voice? Did he speak in that voice? Did he speak in that voice?
Yes, he did.
Yes.
I never missed dinner. You never.
Because it was always going to be something.
Always.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Yes, it was wonderful. It was always a lesson to be learned.
Yes. Derek Murray, we have to say shout out to Derek Murray, guys, because Derek, it's my understanding, Derek, that this was your idea. I want to talk to Oprah in just a second about her love for Sidney Poitier, which, guys, I have known about for forever, And I was there when she first met him, so it was really quite a moment. So I understand how much she loves him. But Derek, this project was your idea. Where does your love for Sidney Poitier come from?
I had the opportunity to meet Sidney for the first time as an 11-year-old boy in a theater just like this, and absolutely transfixed with this man, this black man who is a teacher, into Sir with Love. And it just moved me. I came out of that theater thinking that I wanted more. Maybe this was selfish, but I wanted more from my role models, from my teachers, from my coaches, for the adults in my life. And it took me a long time to really react to this. And 50 years later, I was sitting with Joanna and with Sidney and the family talking about making this film.
But I understand, Derek, that the clips that were chosen, that you were the one who had to curate those. That's what I just can't imagine how monumental that task was. How do you decide what to include? How do you go and find all of the clips that you did? Can you just briefly describe the process that you used?
Absolutely, but there's a team of people that at our company that in the archival group, and of course the writer and the editor, that are instrumental in that, that literally spent a year and a half pouring through the content, but most importantly, the foundational interview that you see that drives the story. Going back to what you said, Pamela, it was so important that Sidney tell his own story, which was the vision for this movie, and it was clearly the way the movie had to be made. But that goes to Oprah for sitting down with Sidney and doing, as you suggested, 2 days of interviews, 8 hours of content that was just so valuable for this movie.
I know last night at the premiere, Oprah was called the North Star of this project, and I absolutely, I know I'm biased, but I absolutely think and know that's true. So Oprah, I'm curious about when you did that interview with Sidney, you guys had started this project before his death. You were planning this documentary before his death, true?
Long before his death.
So when you started the interviews, what were you thinking? Because the interviews that you saw where Sidney's talking face to face with camera with a gray background, those were your interviews, and then you incorporated it. Tell us that process and what
before we
your
start,
intention.
I just want to give a shout out to Cherry Wood and Catherine Orr, who are in here,
yes.
Who are our producers.
Yes.
Thank
yes,
you,
yes.
Because there's a whole team of us. We're working on looking at edits, deciding what goes in, what goes out, and Terry and Catherine were a huge part of that as executive producers. Well, I have loved him all my life, and as you see in the film, when Quincy Jones had a 42nd birthday party for me, we met each other, and it was an instant bond of friendship. So he was my brother, my father, my friend, and when I was approached by Reginald Hudlin about being a producer, I said, you know, I have all of these hours of footage that I had done when I first started my network OWN in 2012, and someone else had, I had gone to just support the interview that we were doing for a show called Masterclass, and somebody else was interviewing him, and I didn't like the way they were interviewing him, and so I injected myself. I said, well, you're not asking.
Move.
I said, you're not asking the question about the time that he went to get to the cleaners and they followed him in the car and they had the gun to his head. You didn't ask him the question about not seeing a mirror. And so I took over the interview. And that interview lasted for 4.5 hours the first day. We didn't finish. I said, there's still so many stories to tell. Sidney, you didn't tell the time about going to the back door and the woman saying, why are you here? Going to the front door and she's saying, why are you here? And so we did it.
Was he getting tired during the interview? Because that's 2 days of interviews. A long time.
It's unheard of.
Yes,
it's unheard of.
I know it is.
And I just wanted it on record. And when I finished, he said that I could use it for my network, but I could only run it one time. And in cable, you know, things run over and over and over again. And I was saying, oh, only one time. He said, because my story is all my family will have when I'm gone. Mm. And so I don't want it to be played over and over and over and over again. So his family gave me permission to use all those hours that I'd spent.
Thank you, family.
Thank you, family.
Yes. Thank you, family. I mean, Sidney, I loved when you said...
You all should have them. You know what? I'm going to make sure that you all get the full 8 hours. You all would love having the full 8 hours. Yes.
Oh, the unedited version. That's not... What a treasure to have. Sidney, you said you saw your dad make
women swoon, you saw him make men swoon.
Yes,
that's true. That's true.
True story.
He was definitely swoon-worthy for so many people for so long.
Yeah.
And what was it about him that you think made people swoon?
I mean, I don't know that you can quantify it. He just has this special element, this divine, ethereal quality that you don't see in other human beings. You recognize it the minute that you meet him. A stranger on the street who came up to say hello to him and profess their love or admiration would feel like the most important person in the world. He will fix you with a gaze. He will give you his full presence, and he will love you. He loves people, and he loves humanity, and he just has this power and strength that is indescribable, really.
You know, what I like so much, Pamela, he was clearly a girl dad. Six daughters, guys. Six daughters. A girl dad. And he made it clear that he said, we are not a blended family, we are all family, because you are Sidney's daughters by two different women. And I love that you all said that he fell in love with two very strong women. Clearly, all of you were all very close. And that was important to all of you, true?
True.
Yes.
It's very important that we support each other, that we know that we are family, because in the bottom line, it's going to be us, all mm-hmm. of us, and we're going to have to be together, and we're going to have to, you know, support each other and love each other.
Mm-hmm. And our moms felt the same way. Yeah. It was important for our moms to love each other and be friends and know that the kids were all going to grow up together, and we had two very strong, loving, caring, beautiful moms that made that a priority.
Mm-hmm.
Pamela,
Beverly?
Pamela coined a phrase, because our mother is Juanita, and their mother is Joanna. And so Pamela, just to make it easy, would say, JP squared.
JP squared.
You know what I wanted to say? I wanted to say something that I felt that I knew him so well. I read the biographies, other people's stories about him. But what I learned from the film, in the making of the film, and listening to the interviews with the daughters, is that ultimately, when he wrote his book, Measure of a Man, he said that the measure of a man was how well he takes care of his family. And I've interviewed over 35,000 people one-on-one, many of them famous people. And for the most part, famous people live this life where there's this external life, and they bring that life home with them, and their children live in the shadow of it. But what I recognized with this film is that you all didn't have to live in his shadow. You actually lived in his light. Yes. Because primarily, his love for his daughters and his love for his family was the primary essence of him. And that the external world that he showed to all of us was that. But that when he came home, he didn't bring his loneliness with him. He didn't bring his struggles with him. And so, to me, I love him even more after this film, because I understand that what he did for his family and for his daughters, and how they got to see the real him and not the movie star, and how you all thought of him, even to this day, as not as the movie star, but he was our dad. And that takes a special man to do that. Yes.
Amen.
I mean, Derek, I also think his life was so many firsts. You know, he wasn't supposed to be here. The story about he was born 2 months premature, they had actually gotten a shoebox to prepare for his death. He was the first black man nominated for an Oscar, the first black man to win an Oscar, the first black man to kiss a white woman on stage. I mean, now on screen, now that's just no big deal. But back then, it was groundbreaking and earth-shattering. Was there anything, Derek, after looking at all the clips that you did, that you learned about him that you did not know?
Every corner. I mean, we brought in content from all over the world. There's at least 70 or 80 archival sources in this film. And, of course, the family contributed content as well. I really have to say, the one thing I didn't know was that apparently he wasn't a singer, as we learned in Lilies of the Field. One thing I just wanted to add as well, there's so much love in this room and up here with us, but I just want to say that Reggie Hudlin regrets, unfortunately, he had to fly back to Los Angeles. Apparently he's producing this little thing called the Emmys.
Yes.
So we're here in his spirit, and of course he's the director of this film and deserves a lot of credit for what you see on the screen.
Yes. The other thing that was so impressive about Sidney Poitier is that even when he needed the money, guys, he needed the money, if he didn't think that the role did justice to him, did justice to the black race, he would not accept the role. I think that's extraordinary, Sherry, that he went through all of that and decided to pick and choose even then.
Because of...
Can you hold your mic up a little
bit? I'm sorry. Because of his integrity.
Yes.
That he had, not just for his family, but for you all. He gave you each a part of him. And he always taught us how to respect not just the family, but every single person that comes before your eyes. Mm-hmm. Because you don't know their story. And we need to share the love. Let us just come together as one. We've gone through too much in this world.
Actually, Gail, it was Pamela who was the finance baby when he didn't take that movie. Wasn't it you, Pamela? Yeah.
I was a baby on credit.
You were a credit baby on credit, yes.
Have you paid that back yet?
No, it was in my bill.
Her sister asked her, have you paid that back yet? And you said
it wasn't,
no.
It wasn't my bill to pay.
Yes.
I was the gift. Yes.
I know, but yes. Pamela, since you are the credit baby,
yes.
What did that mean to you to know that it was more important that he had integrity and grace with his family than getting a check? You know, so many actors today will say, look, I knew that wasn't a good movie, but I need the money. And I apologize for that, they'll say, but I really needed the money. That was not your dad.
No, and I think that I inherited a lot of that integrity, as we all did, but particularly me, because I thought that took a lot of guts. That took a lot of inner strength to say no. Mm-hmm. This is not a movie I want to make. Mm-hmm. This is not representing my father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, my daughters. I cannot do this movie. Mm-hmm. And I think he realized the power of film and storytelling. If you don't tell it right, you're teaching people wrong. Woo. Okay.
Preach, sister Pamela. You don't tell it right, you're teaching people wrong.
You're teaching people wrong.
And one other thing he always taught us was that in this business, they can take everything away from you, but they can never take away your ability to say no, and that your no is as powerful or more powerful sometimes than your yes.
Mm. I think that...
Beverly?
I was just going to say that one thing that has been a guiding light for me all my life is that knowing that everything that you do in life has consequences, and that, like you were saying, you can't do a film because you need to pay for the hospital, because it has consequences on how that's going to affect other people, you know, and you always have to behave true to yourself. And, you know, I think that's the biggest legacy, is that you have to behave true to yourself regardless of how uncomfortable or how it doesn't advance your quote career.
But I think you need to know who you are first.
Well, obviously, yeah.
Before.
I mean, yeah, we're you know, one and two, so we.
But I think once you know who you are, but that's a journey in itself. Mm-hmm. You have to know where you come from. You have to know who you are so that you know where you're going. Mm-hmm. And if you don't embrace all of your past, all of your life, then you don't know who you are, and you're walking around as half a person. Mm-hmm. And Daddy knew who he was.
Yes.
From Cat Island, he knew who he was. No one could tell him who he was. And I think once you get that sense of self and you have gone through that journey, then no one can tell you anything that is not going to be correct with your soul.
Mm-hmm. The other thing in the movie that I thought, because it's not just, I think it's a love letter to Sidney for sure, but it also delves into some uncomfortable things in his life. You know, the divorce, they talked about the relationship with Diane Carroll and how, I was very moved that he said after 11 years of psychotherapy that it still bothered him and it still haunted him. I mean, that to me spoke volumes about the man, that he was criticized by the black community for thinking that he's, he's, why does white America love Sidney Poitier so much? Did you all have a conversation ever about race in your house?
Yes, a lot. I want to say that I did not realize that there was conflict between Daddy and the, quote, black community.
You didn't?
No, I didn't. Mm-hmm. And I was talking to him one day, and I said, there was an article that, I can't remember the writer's name, and I was like, oh, Daddy, there's an article about you, so-and-so wrote it. And his reaction was not good. And I said, what do you mean? What's going on? I said, oh, it's a good article. He said, well, we'll see. I mean, you know, I have some history with that guy. And I was like, you know, doesn't everybody love you? I mean, I don't know. But, you know, it was not until I started, I researched it back and, mm-hmm. to find out that that was something that was going on. I had no idea.
And how does that sit with you, Beverly, when you hear that?
That people are wrong. Uh-huh. You know, that yeah. they're wrong. But also it's like, I have a problem when you say, this person speaks for the black community.
Yes.
You know, I don't even know that person.
Yeah.
You know, this is a person who is an American, who is a black person. They speak for themselves, and you can take a look at them and see how some people are. You know, but you are, everyone is just a human being in the long run. Mm-hmm. So, you know, saying that the black community, like that was the thing that irritated me in the movie.
In the movie?
You know, I can't remember the guy's name. I should be nice to him, but anyway. He said, Sidney Poitier, you know, black people didn't like it. The white people did, but the black, how do you know? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm calming down. Go ahead.
No. But Oprah, that was helpful to you. I recall Sidney being very helpful to you about that very same topic.
Well, one of the reasons we bonded so strongly is on that first night that we met, I was going through it with members of the black community who felt that I wasn't being black enough on TV, that I was hugging white people too much. Hello, white people.
Oprah, white people are everywhere.
I was hugging white people. I wasn't doing enough black shows. And so our first conversation, I sat down and said, it's just such a burden. You know, how did you handle that? And he said, my dear, it's always a challenge when you are carrying other people's dreams.
Wow.
So recognize you're carrying other people's dreams, but the most important dream is the one that you hold for yourself. And yes. So the thing that the sisters have been talking about is holding on to the truth of yourself. And so he was my counsel, he was my guide, he was my instructor, he was my friend through that entire process of, you know, gaining fame and trying to handle it and how holding on to yourself through that. Because as you all know, so many people, maybe y'all don't know, but a lot of people lose themselves. But what I learned from Sidney Poitier is that you are who you are, and that fame nor money can change you if you are solidly grounded in knowing who you are, as the sisters were saying. Coming into it knowing who you are.
Yes. They said we're out of time, we have to go, but Oprah, I do want to wrap up with you because one of the most touching things for me in the film, I know that Oprah's a very emotional person, I get that. She's chief empathy. When it comes to empathy, she feels people very, very strongly. But I was surprised, Oprah, when you were talking and your voice was so strong, and then you just cracked. What happened in that moment to you?
Well, I cracked.
But I'm only questioning it because I didn't see it coming, and I know how much
I didn't
you
see
love
it coming
man.
Either.
Yeah.
And it was that thing where you know you're going to go into the ugly cry. And you got two cameras and one's on the side angle, and that really ain't gonna be good. When they see that jaw doing that. So I covered.
No, it was very touching. It was very touching.
I covered my face. Well, it was just in that moment where everything that I felt for him, I'd been talking about him for a couple of hours with Reginald Hudlin, our director, and just it all just came to a head when I was just thinking about all that he has meant to me and all that I know that he means to the world, and So I cracked, and so I didn't have anything else to say.
So close it out. Listen, I know you know you've had very strong connections with Nelson Mandela, with Maya Angelou, with Quincy Jones, with, you know, the list goes on and on and on. I'll stop name dropping. But Sidney Poitier, you said, has been the most important person in your life. Why? You said you wouldn't be you without him.
Well, because he kicked the doors open for me. I mean, the fact that there was an Oprah Winfrey show or could be an Oprah Winfrey show is because he came first. Yes. And without even knowing it, humanized blackness. He humanized the idea of what it means to be a black person and humanized what it means to be a successful black person and made that acceptable in the eyes of people who heretofore didn't know or weren't aware. And so his being who he was and you know, to echo what's been said here, he saw and felt everybody because he was so curious about life and about other people and treated everybody the same. And his ability to do that came from the core of him. What you see in the beginning of the film where he talks about, you know, being 10 years old and I'd never seen a mirror before. I love that moment. The fact that his identity came built on respect and character and not on the color of his skin. And his honor and duty to what his parents had given him was the most important thing. And every piece of art, every piece of work that he created or directed came from the spirit and core of that. So when you're looking at his work, when you're looking at his art, when you're looking at him acting, when you're looking at him in an interview, all of that is coming from the central core of who he is. And that is the gift that he has left us with. The spirit of who he is and was as a man allows us to see what is possible.
Yes.
Because
yes.
If he could be that way, the first thing I thought when I saw him on the screen, if he could do that, I wonder what he could do, what I can do. And the same thing is true for all of us who have now witnessed his life. If he can go through 94 years being true to himself, living honor for himself, living through a sense of integrity, not taking the easy way out, not taking the money, even when it would have been convenient and eased his pain needed, and his family's pain and suffering. If he could do that, I wonder what you can do.
All right.
I wonder what you could do.
Thank you. Thank you, Beverly. Thank you, Pamela, Sherry.
Thank you all.
Anika.
Thank you.
Sidney, Derek, Oprah. Thank you, audience.
Tell your friends about the film.